Good morning. Welcome to Grace. Happy Thanksgiving. Please stand and join us. Thank you.
addictions. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
No heart or death can separate. Steadfast love who can escape. Faithfulness and endless sea. So full of grace.
Thank God, it's so good. God, it's so good. God, it's so good. It's so good to me.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Brian Balson, and I serve on the elders team here at Grace. So God is so good. The weather is incredible. Happy Thanksgiving to everyone. And also, this is Pastor Appreciation Month, so we'd like to certainly thank our pastors, Shane and John. Yeah. And of course, we would want to extend that to the staff and all of the volunteers who make everything happen here at Grace. Without everyone pitching in and doing their thing, things just would not happen. So we want to give thanks to God for providing us with the people who are willing to do what they do in order that we can have a healthy and vibrant church in our community. So a few announcements here. They are in your bulletin, but there's some that they would just want us to highlight. We want to extend a welcome to those who are watching online, and of course to everyone that's here today, but especially to those, that, if this is your first time or you've just started attending here, thank you for selecting Grace, and please just check in with the welcome desk if you're first time here. We do have a welcome gift there for you, and we just want to know a little bit more about you and you about us, and help you connect here at Grace. On October 14th, there's a Bible quiz meet happening here at the church. There's going to be around 200 children at this meet. Isn't that phenomenal that there's going to be that many people? Yeah. And so Debbie is looking for some help in order to provide them with snacks, because the Bible quizzing, the brains are working, so they eat a little more sugar and a little more stuff to keep them going. So if you'd like to drop off some baked goods for the kids to have on the 14th and 15th, please just bring them to the office or talk to Debbie or somebody at the welcome desk. On Sunday the 16th, there's a concert of prayer, and the prayer focuses on missionaries. So please be able to attend there. It's 5 o'clock next Sunday. On the 22nd, Saturday the 22nd, Pastor John is doing a seminar, Discover Your Place. And it's basically an orientation to Grace Baptist Church. You can sign up for the seminar at the welcome desk or through the church office as well. Three more seminars coming up in November and December, including this one, are Discover Your Priorities, one on ministry, and the other on missions. And we're in the process of updating our church directory. So if you're new and not in the directory, we are going to be taking pictures here on Sunday, October 23rd and the 30th at 8:45 to 12:30. If you're already in the directory and you want to update your picture from the 80s or 90s or whenever the last one was, please feel free to join us and get your picture done too. If you're in the giving mode, please, there's a slot on the wall. It's now marked. It's just across from the welcome desk beside the door on your way out there. And you can drop the offering off there. Or you can check graceairdrie.ca/donate and find different ways of doing that. And for other information, please just check your bulletin. And again, happy Thanksgiving. And please let me pray. Lord God, we just thank you so much, not just for the beautiful weather that you're giving us and experiencing a fall like its unbelievable colors. We can only imagine what heaven might be like, Lord. We thank you for our pastors and staff and volunteers and those coming to church. Lord, we just pray for peace and understanding and how we can go out and just help spread your word in this challenging world that we're living in right now, Lord. We just pray for guidance, for wisdom, just for the handling of the resources that you provide us with, that they're being put to where you want them to be. Lord, we just pray for our community and for those struggling, for those who are maybe sick or infirm or just questioning or just not feeling good. Lord, we just feel that they would be covered by your grace and your peace and your love, and they would just maybe experience you for a first time or for a new time and have a new beginning. We just give all thanks to you, and we just pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please rise as we take Thanksgiving responsive reading. So responsive reading, I'll read the first line and then you read the next line. It's going to be on the screen. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. God blesses us with gifts of love. God blesses us with daily work. God protects us in time of danger. God calls us into relationship with Him. Therefore, shall we offer thanks and praise to the Lord our God. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name.
Chase of God, born of the Spirit.
submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, I'm happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, kept in His love.
Thank you for the blessed assurance that you've given us. God, we thank you that one day we'll be with you in your presence. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everybody. Happy Thanksgiving. Happy Thanksgiving to those who are watching online. You know, it is one of my favorite times of the year. Mainly because this is the time where Costco brings back their pumpkin pies. I have been waiting a long time for this, right? It's just a very short season. You know, but also, it's the start of baseball playoffs. And this might be painful for those of you that are Blue Jay fans. Just, I feel your pain. I feel it, but there's room for you to jump on the Dodger bandwagon. Okay? The pursuit of the World Series starts on Tuesday for us. You know, that's so like for the next month, my head's probably just going to be spinning just thinking about baseball, but it's a good time of year. We're talking about five different biblical assurances this morning. And I think it is timely for us to talk about things that Scripture is adamant about, that Scripture gives us assurance about, guarantees. Because we live in a world that is saturated, absolutely saturated with lies. You know, this last summer I read a book by C.S. Lewis called The Screwtape Letters. I don't know if you're familiar with the book. But the book is a series of different letters that is written from a devil. The devil's name is Screwtape. And what Screwtape is writing these letters for is he's writing them to a younger, more inexperienced devil named Wormwood. Screwtape is writing to Wormwood. And these letters are composed of different admonishes, exhortations, even rebukes. But it's all directed towards Screwtape giving Wormwood guidance and direction as Wormwood tries to lead a young man away from Christ. He writes this, Screwtape says this to the young Wormwood. He says, "But do remember, the only thing that matters is the extent to which you separate the man from the enemy." Remember, the perspective is from a devil writing to another devil about how to lead someone away from Christ. So the enemy here is, he's talking about God. So he's saying, all that matters is the extent to which you separate man from God. It does not matter how small the sins are, provided the cumulative effect is to edge the man away from the light and out into nothing. See, what the enemy wants is for all of mankind to remain apart from their Creator. You know, we all collectively, whether you are a new Christian, whether you've been a Christian your whole life, maybe even if you're here this morning or watching online and you have not given your life over to Jesus Christ, you know, we all find ourselves in the same position. We all actually have the same enemy. We all have the same enemy. His name is the devil. And he seeks to keep us from the light. Peter, he says something along these lines in 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. He says, "Be sober and alert. Your enemy, the devil, like a roaring lion, is on the prowl looking for someone to devour." Ever since mankind has been created, Satan has been looking to lead them away from God. Think back to the Garden of Eden with me. You know, the very first picture that we actually see of Satan in Genesis chapter 3, the very, very first picture we see of him, he's trying to utilize a tactic in order to lead God's people astray. This is what becomes critical for us to note this morning, because he is still employing the same tactic. This is what he says in Genesis 3, verse 1. It says, "Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, 'Did God really say, you must not eat from any tree in the garden?'" Did you guys catch the tactic? Did God really say? You know, what Satan tries to do is he tries to diminish. He'll try to change. He'll even alter. He'll try to depower or try to cast doubt on the validity of what God's word says. And he tries to cast this doubt so that the authority that is in the word of God alone. I mean, we're talking about the power and authority that simply even created everything. Just the words of God in the creation narrative brought everything into being. We're talking about this kind of power. And what he wants to do is he wants to cast a doubt on whether or not we actually believe and trust in that power and authority. So he asks, he gets us the question, did God really say? If he can cast any doubt or make a believer question what God says, then it's just another way in which the evil one continues to move God's people or all of humanity farther and farther from the light and out into nothing. Let's just have a look at our current culture today. Let's just have a look at the war that's being waged against God and his word today. Just using that simple phrase, did God really say, right? Did God really say that there are only two genders? Did God really say that sex before marriage is destructive? Did God really say that the love of money is evil? Did God really say that people of the same gender cannot pledge themselves to one another? Did God really say that you need to be a part of a local church for growth and accountability? Did God really say that your life is actually tied to God's word? Did God really say? Listen, our culture, our country, our world, we're being told a whole bunch of lies about everything from gender to race to sexuality, even what it means for Christians to love their neighbor. And if our worldview on things is not firmly rooted and what God says in his word, we will be susceptible to not only believe lies, but when we believe it, we live them out, which continues to move us farther and farther from the light out into the nothing. And this is the very thing the Screwtape is urging Wormwood to do. Flood the mind of the believer with lies so that they can no longer distinguish what is true. You know, in a few moments, we're going to look at five different critical areas for the life of the Christian that Satan tries to cast doubt on, that Satan constantly attacks, where he's flooding lies. You know, Satan's going to try to cast doubt on our salvation, whether we believe that we're actually saved. He's going to try to cast doubt on the validity of prayer, whether we think it's needed or even necessary. He'll try to cast doubt on our ability to say no when we face times of temptation. He's going to try to cast doubt on whether God actually forgives us when we mess up. He wants to cast doubt on whether God is actually going to lead us and guide us in this life. And why does he do this? Why is it that the evil one is so intent on attacking what God says? Well, we actually have to understand that he can't do anything but that. Satan is the father of lies. Jesus, when talking to the Judeans in John chapter 8, he says this about Satan. He says, starting in verse 44, he says, "You people are from your father the devil, and you want to do what your father desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not uphold the truth, because there is no truth in him. Whenever he lies, he speaks according to his own nature, because he is a liar and is the father of lies. You know, Satan is unable to speak truth at all, at any time. So let's think about this for a quick moment. If he's unable to speak truth, then when we find Jesus being tempted by the evil one in Matthew chapter 4, then what Satan is actually doing is he's bringing falsities towards Jesus. And he's even doing this, even in the second temptation narrative, when Satan is quoting scripture to him. If he's unable to speak truth. See, actually what happens is when he's quoting scripture to Jesus in the second temptation narrative, he is actually misrepresenting it. He doesn't actually quote the whole part of Psalm 91. He actually misses words and leaves stuff out. You know, everything that Satan is presenting to Jesus when he's pandering to his hunger or to his safety or to his lordship, every part of it is false. He's misapplying scripture. And as Dr. David Jeremiah says, the truth misapplied is no better than error applied. The truth misapplied is no better than error applied. You know, Satan, the father of lies, can only speak lies. Therefore, the only way to counter against the lies is to know and believe truth. You know, three times Satan comes against Jesus, three times the response that Jesus gave to him is, "It is written." It is written. See, there's nothing that you or I or all of humanity can ever say on its own that comes close to possessing the powers that the Word of God possesses. You know, Jesus counters with God's Word, and it is this very reason why today that Satan wants to continue to attack it, because it's the only thing that can actually stand up against him. He wants to continue to attack what God says because God's word actually is enough and more to defeat him. Jesus says this to Satan after the first temptation in Matthew 4:4. Man does not live on bread alone, but upon every word that comes from the mouth of God. Jesus understood that the success of his mission to live a sinless life, to die on a cross, and to rise from the dead, all while defeating sin and death on the behalf of a sinful humanity, just like me, sinful people like me, his success is completely tied to the truth of God's word. He needs it. He needed it. And so do we. We need God's word, even now, today, more than ever, because of the lies that are being flooded into our world. And it's one thing to know it, but we need to believe it. We need to know it, we need to believe it, if we are to live for Christ today. So that's why I want us to look at these five different things, five different biblical assurances, these five different critical aspects of our Christian walk that the evil one will try to flood us full of lies so that we don't believe it. And when we don't believe it, we don't live it, and we start moving farther from the light and out into the nothing. These are five biblical assurances. So here's the thing. If the enemy speaks lies and casts doubt, then what is really needed for us today? We need assurance. We need assurance. What do I mean when I say assurance? You know, if Satan is seeking to do when he casts doubt on the validity of God's word, is he's really trying to say, it's not trustworthy. You can't trust this. Can you really actually trust what God says? Do you actually think God is right? Do you actually think God has all the answers? He's trying to paint God as someone who is not trustworthy. But assurance seeks to do is to invigorate within you a confidence in your trust of God's word. It's trying to stir something up within us, this assurance, this unwavering confidence that what God actually says is in fact true. See, God is trustworthy. And what he is doing is he's promising to you in his word that what he's actually saying is true and trustworthy. It's true. It's actually a guarantee. So as we kind of look now at these five different areas, these five assurances, what God is actually saying to us through his word is, I am guaranteeing you something today. And the enemy is going to try to diminish or cast doubt. But my word is going to tell you something different. So the first assurance that we want to look at here this morning is the assurance of salvation. Maybe you can relate, but I've found myself at different points and times in my life questioning whether I was saved. You know, Satan will often try to cast doubt upon the work that God has done in our heart. You know, maybe you think, how can this actually be that I can simply just be saved by believing and receiving Jesus? You know, there has to be more. There has to be something else. It seems like everything that happens in this world, whether trying to get ahead financially or trying to build a portfolio or build a business or even like other religions in this world, is always built upon me having to work and do something. Let's just think about some different major religions, like Islam. They believe in five pillars, which basically means that you need to fast, you need to pray five times a day, you need to go on a pilgrimage, you need to give alms, and then you need to confess that Muhammad is the true prophet. You do all of those five things, then maybe you might be saved. There is no guarantee, but it's all about you working at doing it. Same thing with Judaism. Judaism, you have to believe in Yahweh, but then you have to hold to the works of the Mosaic Law. You have to go through all the rituals and all the sacrifices and all the different components. But even then, salvation is only temporary. It is a momentary lapse of your sin. But the next time you leave in sin, well, doom is back on you. Hinduism, it believes that salvation comes through self-improvement over lifetime after lifetime, the reincarnation kind of cycle, that the more and more that I continue to improve and better myself here, then when I die, I'm going to come back as some kind of different life kind of creature, and I'm going to improve myself and keep improving, and then maybe eventually I'll get to this place that they call Brahma. Buddhism, it believes that you will reach nirvana after you completely work at diminishing every single desire within you. So no desires at all. No desire for food, no desire for intimacy, no desire for purpose. You remove every single desire from you. I work at it. And I don't get to nirvana until I accomplish that. See, everything, all these major religions, it's based upon works. You have to contribute to your own salvation. And Paul, he spends an awful lot of time in almost all of his books talking about the fact that their salvation is Christ, period. It's not based on Christ and or Christ plus. He says this in Ephesians 2, 8, 9, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. It is not from yourself. It's the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. He also says in Titus 3, 5, he saved us not because of righteous things we had done, but simply because of his mercy. Christianity is not a belief in Jesus and. There is no and. It's just Jesus. And John, he says this in 1 John 5:13. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life. And this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life. See, what John is not saying, whoever has the Son and does everything he says has life. That's not what he says. He does not say that. There is no Jesus and. Our salvation is through Jesus alone. As Paul outlines in Romans 10:9, if you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You know, the evil one is going to want to try to complicate things for us. This is why literally every single religion that speaks of some aspect of salvation, getting to a better place, is all based upon the lie of works. Christianity is only the only religion that says you can't do it, but Christ and Christ alone can. We don't need to work off any debt to him. We don't owe him anything. It's just Jesus and. And this is our assurance. If you believe in the Son of God, you have eternal life. That is God's guarantee to us today. Don't let the evil one cause you to doubt it. We have assurance of salvation. Secondly, we have assurance of answered prayer. You know, I believe Satan wants us to doubt the effectiveness of prayer. One of the best ways that Satan works to suffocate our prayer life is through convincing us that we are self-sufficient, that we are completely self-sustaining. You know, this makes us wonder and ask those questions, why do I need to pray? If I can do things on my own, why do I need to actually pray? What do I get out of this? And if I could do it on my own, then why would God actually be interested in having a relationship with me? Why does he want me to actually engage with him? Why do I need to pray? And this is what we need to understand about prayer. When you pray, you are inviting God into your midst. You are engaging in a relationship. I feel like often when we participate in prayer, so much of our prayer lives are based upon we have our list of things that we would like to bring to God. And that is completely okay. I mean, Paul talks about this in Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Don't be anxious about anything. In every situation, by prayer and petition, present your requests to God. Yeah, he absolutely wants to have us bring him those prayer requests. He wants to hear our burdens. He wants us to praise him and to commune with him. But what we need to understand is that when we pray, we actually have two things we receive. We're always going to receive an answer from God. Okay? We're always going to receive an answer, but we will also always receive his presence. Listen to what Jesus tells us. He said this to his disciples in John 16, 24. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. You know, this verse comes on the heels of Jesus telling his disciples that soon he's going to be leaving, he's going to go to the Father, and then he's going to have the Holy Spirit come. You know, what Jesus is implying here is that when we pray in his name, when we pray in Jesus' name, you are then asking based upon the authority and the merit of Jesus. The authority and merit of Jesus. Our whole ability to pray, to receive the presence of God, to receive from him, to actually commune with him, is based upon Jesus. This is why the author of Hebrews says, now we can boldly go to the throne with confidence. Not because of who we are, but because of what Jesus has done for us. We're praying on his authority and his merit. And based upon that, he will answer. He will answer us. But what happens is we also gain his presence. Theologian Sam Storms, he says this, joy is not necessarily the absence of suffering, but it is the presence of God. See, when we pray in Jesus' name, when we ask in his name, we will receive. We will receive. And sometimes that reception is, yes, you can go and do this. Sometimes it's a no. Sometimes it's just a hold on. Sometimes it's, we're just going to kind of let things percolate a little bit. But God will always come to us and give us some form of an answer. But the other thing that he does is then he says, your joy will be complete when you pray in my name. When you come to me in prayer, I will make your joy complete. This doesn't mean that he's going to make our joy complete by curing us of cancer or giving us that raise. And that does form joy within us, but that's not the joy that Jesus is talking about. The joy that he's talking about is now we have the ability in his name, the authority and merit of Jesus alone, to approach the throne of grace to receive. And when we actually do that, he gives us himself. He makes our joy complete. See, this is what Job realized at the end of the book of Job in chapter 42. His whole life, as we see through the book of Job, is just riddled with suffering and hurt and pain and turmoil. But yet at the very end of it, this is what Job says to God in chapter 42, verse 5. He says, "My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you." That is what God intends to do when we pray, is to let us have his presence. We will see God. Jesus says, "Ask and you will receive. You will receive an answer, but you will also always receive the presence of God." This is God's guarantee to us today. We have assurance of answered prayer. Thirdly, we have assurance of victory. Ultimately, we have absolute victory over sin and death through Jesus Christ. But we are still left here on this earth battling against the flesh, battling against the world, battling against the devil. And Satan seeks to plant seeds of doubt in our mind, believing that we will always give in to our temptations, that there is no hope for us, that we will fail. And that continues to then spur within us these feelings of loneliness or isolation or these defeated feelings. Here's the thing, we have a Savior, Jesus Christ, who understands the temptations that come our way. Remember, the author of Hebrews, he says this, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been tempted in every way and yet did not sin." Jesus gets it. He knows how hard it is in this world, in this life, to live for him, to say no to the fleshly desires, to say no to the temptations of the evil one, to say no to the ways of the world. He knows how hard it is. He gets it. This is why he then promises us something. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, he says, "No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it." See, Paul is trying to comfort the Corinthians with the thought that God would not allow any unbearable situation to come their way. See, what this basically means is that every temptation that we find ourselves in, every single one, we have hope. We are not doomed to fail. We're not doomed to fail. Why? Because an unbearable temptation means that there's no way that we can bear it. We will give in. We will fall. But that's not what the word says. It says that we will not be given any temptation which we cannot bear. That means that every single temptation that comes our way is bearable. God is saying that he has made a way for all of us to resist every temptation. Now, here's something we have to remember about temptation. We usually view it as this external thing that comes against us, right? And in many cases, that is the fact. But we have a sin nature. It is within all of us to want to sin against the authority of God, which basically means that we create our own temptations. The author, James, he says this in James 1:14, "But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed." What this simply means is that you, me, we need to actually take personal responsibility for our own choices. Remember, God says that the temptation will not be beyond what we can bear. And that His promise, that is His promise to us. So that means that in every single time of temptation, we can make the personal choice. We can make that choice to say no. We can say no to it. And we can say yes to righteousness. It's because of that that we will not be doomed to fail. We don't have to feel defeated time and time and time again, because God has made a way for us to say yes to righteousness and no to our temptations. We can have victory. Fourthly, there is assurance of forgiveness. These are back to back, because we know that ultimately, even though we're not doomed to fail, we do. We all fall short of the glory of God, right? We all mess up. We all give in to temptations and sin. Yeah, there are times of victory, but there are also times of defeat. And what Satan loves to do in those times of defeat is to make you feel like you are worthless and unlovable. That because you gave in to this temptation, well, how on earth is God going to love you now? Well, here's the good news. God does not see us as worthless or unlovable. You know, one of the many things that amazes me about God is that He knows just how busted and broken that I am. But yet, He still has this incredible love for me that He lavishes on me time and time and time again. He knows me. He's made me. He knows I'm going to mess up. But guess what? It does not faze Him at all. Doesn't faze Him. Romans 5:8, Paul says this, but God demonstrates His own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He saved us knowing that we were sinners. He knows that I'm going to fall short, that I'm not going to be able to do everything that I know I'm supposed to. But His love compels Him still to present forgiveness to me. When I mess up, Satan is going to try to cast doubt on us, but God will never, ever turn His back on us when we mess up. 1 John 1:9, this is what it says. It says, if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just, and He will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Man, what an amazing verse. When we mess up, when we go to God and when we confess before Him, God, I fell short here. Would you forgive me? This is what His word tells us He will do. He's going to do two things. First, He says He will forgive us. And this is basically what it means. Delete it from the memory bank. He deletes it from the memory bank. No recollection of our sins and our wrongs. When He sees you, He sees us covered by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. He does not see our sin. He does not see our faults. He sees the righteousness of Jesus Christ. He forgives and He forgets. But the second thing that He does is that He continues to purify us from all unrighteousness. He wants to purify us from all unrighteousness. Basically means that God will continue His intent to finish what He has started in us. So not only is He going to sit there and say, well, your sin and all the bad stuff, it causes this distance. No, no, no. Guess what? I have even more resolve now to make sure that I am seeing through in your life the very thing that my word says I'm going to do. I'm going to complete you. I'm going to finish what I started. Philippians 1:6, being confident of this, that He who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Just because we mess up does not mean that God is done with us. Not at all. We can come to Him. He will forgive us. and he will continue to do the good work that he has set out and has started in us. This is God's guarantee to us today. We have assurance of forgiveness. Finally, we have assurance of guidance. Earlier, I had mentioned that Satan desires for us to be self-sufficient, meaning that we don't need God for anything. But part of God completing his good work in us, it basically speaks that he's going to actually continue to lead us and guide us. He's not just going to do a bunch of internal things. He's going to show us the way that we need to go so that we can walk that way while he does the things that he needs to do in us. You know, as a good father seeks to give direction to his child, this is what God seeks to do for his children. He wants to guide them and direct them. Maybe today you might be wondering, you know, does God actually have a plan for me? Does he have a will for my life? Is he really concerned about how I live or what I do? Is he really going to lead me? You know, there's an old hymn, "He leadeth me." These are just some wonderful words. It says, "He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O words with heavenly comfort fraught, whatever I do, whenever I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me." Wonderful words. But our world, the devil, he doesn't want us to believe that those are actually true. Does God actually lead us? Does he actually guide us in this world? His word says he does. Proverbs 3, 5 to 6. "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight." Guess what? We're not left alone in this world to figure all this stuff out. We're not left alone in this world to try to figure out how to say no to temptation. We're not left alone in this world to figure out, you know, if I can actually pray to God or will he accept me when I mess up. God leads us. He guides us. See, God promises to lead you and to direct your paths when you rely on him. I love this verse from Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21. "Whether you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, 'This is the way. Walk in it.'" Friends, this is God's guarantee to us this morning. When we rely upon him, he is faithful and he will do what he has set out to do. Direct our steps. He will light our paths and he will not leave us alone. We have assurance of guidance. Friends, this morning we have a very real enemy and he desperately wants to keep God's children from the light. But that is exactly where we are meant to be. God wants all of us, not just us. He wants all of us, our community, our province, our country, our world, to know him, to live in the light, to not live in darkness where we are not designed to be. We are designed to be with God. And the evil one, the enemy, will do anything and everything he can to try to cast doubt on that. And his main go-to tactic starts with trying to get us to believe that God and his word are not trustworthy. This is why Jesus, in the temptation, in the second one, in Matthew 4:4, he can go to Satan and say, "Man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God," because our life is completely wrapped up in God's word. Because that is how we know God, is through his word. So it's no brainer that that's what the evil one is going to try to attack. You know, maybe this morning you've come here, maybe you're watching online, maybe you have not yet come into the light. You need to know that this morning, it doesn't matter what you've done, God will forgive you. God will give you salvation from your sins. He will make a way for you to come and be with him forever. Jesus will help us He will answer our prayers. He will give us wisdom and guidance in temptation. He will forgive us when we mess up. And Jesus will guide us in this life. This is not wishful thinking. This is a guarantee. God assures us. The evil one will seek to keep us from being in the light, but it is God's word as our defender that will help us to ward off the fiery arrows of the devil and actually experience the full joy of the Lord. Would you join me as we pray? Our Father in heaven, we are thankful for your word. We're thankful that in the midst of a world that is full of lies and deception, that you have given us your authoritative truth, that we can have it and hold it, that we can read it, that we can be mindful of it, that we can put it into our hearts, and that it can be our guiding light as we try to navigate this world that is sought to intend to destroy our relationship with you, our Creator, our Savior, our Lord, our King. But Lord, may your word continue to speak to us this morning, giving us reassurance that even in any of these areas that we talked about this morning, whether it's through salvation or prayer or temptation or forgiveness or guidance, that the evil one has maybe sought to lead us into doubt, or that we've questioned who you are and your authority in these areas, Lord, we come before you, we confess and ask for your Spirit to again make us new and reassure us through your word that you are trustworthy and your word is trustworthy. And that no matter what comes our way, the fiery arrows of the evil one, we have your truth and we can live by it. So Father, continue to bless us with your word today. Bless us with the reassurance of your incredible love for us today, and we thank you so much for being with us in these times. In your name we pray, amen.
Thanks, Pastor Shane. Please stand and join us again.
They'll say my God is still the same as the walls. If they still fall at the mighty sound of praise, they'll say my God is still the same. When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail? Never has, never will. Say my God is still the same as
great need.